Well, good morning, everyone, and good afternoon, I should say. I'm Ken Maffley, and I'll be your moderator for today. And today, we're going to be talking about accelerating business growth with digital product creation. And more specifically, how to reach out more effectively through digital selling. So, while everyone is kind of filtering in and getting settled, we will be publishing our first poll of the day to kind of get everyone settled in, and that is, what do you spend the most money on when you do your online shopping? Since we're going to be talking about digital selling today, a little icebreaker to see what everyone kind of spends the most money on, especially over the last 6 months while we've kind of been cloistered in our homes. So, please feel free to cast your vote, and we will share the results a little bit later. I feel like since we're talking to a fashion audience, that clothing and footwear might win, but honestly, people might still prefer that in-store shopping experience. So the jury's still out on that. So please go ahead and cast your vote, and we'll share the results a little bit later. With us today, we have Mo Gise and Ellery Connell. Mo is the process optimization project director here at, or actually at PVH Europe. He started his career actually as a sales manager at Hugo Boss, so he comes with a strong understanding of that sales and sales process. But during his time at PVH Europe, he's worked for both Calvin Klein and Tommy Hilfiger. He now devotes all his time to Tommy Hilfiger, where he's been instrumental in the adoption of 3D design for Tommy's footwear team. So welcome, Mo. Thanks for being
Hi.
aboard. Hey.
Hello, Ken. Nice to be here.
Yeah, and great to have you with us.
Thank
I
you.
actually look forward to our conversation a little bit in just a few moments. By the way, and before I continue, everyone, now that more people are starting to join, as we continue our conversation, if you have any questions at all, please feel free to put them in the chat or question pane, and we'll make sure to get to them during our Q&A session at the end of our time. So also with us today, of course, is Ellery. Ellery is our lead technical and creative solutions specialist here at Foundry. He's a 20-plus year veteran of 3D modeling. He's a teacher, speaker, and author, where he literally wrote the book on 3D design, which you can find at Amazon.com. While he's not doing all of that, he trains Foundry's clients in both Modo and Colorway, getting them up to speed and proficient in the software, teaching them how to build stunning 3D assets of footwear and products that you would swear that you would just be able to reach into the screen and start using them. So, Ellery, welcome.
Hey, thanks, Ken. Nice to be
Yeah.
here.
All right. So, as is news to no one, our selling landscape has radically changed in the last 6 months. Right. The pandemic has put most of our buyers working from home instead of the office, with a lack of air travel to get to and from places. So we've had to scramble and figure out how to reach out to people in new ways, using existing technology, yes, but then finding innovative ways to use that technology. And the truth of the matter is that while travel restrictions will likely be lifted in the next 6 to 9 months as a vaccine becomes available and as the pandemic starts to wind down, hopefully, buyer travel habits may lag in returning to normal. Well, why is that? Well, the IATA, the International Air Transport Association, published a report recently that said while the world's GDP might return to normal, kind of call it mid 2021, it might take an additional 2 years for international travel to return to pre-pandemic levels. Why is that? lagging consumer confidence in the safety of air travel, right? Even though more reports have been coming out that it's a pretty safe way to travel and not come in contact with COVID, consumer confidence is still really going to lag there, right? People are going to want to take some time to make sure that that's true. There will likely be longer waits at the immigration queue, and certificates of immunity may be required depending on the region that you're coming to and from. Recovery itself might be uneven, leaving some regions tougher to fly to or from. And finally, and probably most importantly, a lot of companies have learned some very valuable lessons here in the last 6 months of new ways of doing business, right? Because at the end of the day, if you can take a 2 or 3 day business trip and condense it down to a couple of video calls and still have the similar amount of ROI or return on investment, why wouldn't you, right? It's more environmentally responsible. You're not using jet fuel to get to and from places. It's easier on people's schedules. It saves companies time and money. So there is a high likelihood that companies have been learning lessons the last 6 months that are going to carry forward. Okay. So that means that our selling landscape has at least temporarily, if not permanently, changed. Well, we've been here before as an industry, right? There have been major disruptions in the past, and people have found innovative ways to meet those challenges. So one is the theater of fashion, and I will do everyone a favor. If you couldn't tell when I was introducing Mo, I have a very American accent that does not do well. So I'll let each of you in your minds pronounce theater of fashion in French, and you will do a much better job. So leave that there. But during the end of World War II, Paris was war-torn. It was liberated, but war-torn. And literally, there was not enough material in Paris to put an entire fashion show together. There just wasn't. And beyond that, there wasn't the infrastructure to hold a fashion show with hotels and arenas and stuff like that. So they wanted to get on with their recovery, and they wanted to put themselves back at the center of fashion. But given these what looked like insurmountable odds, they came up with a very innovative solution. They took the materials that they did have, and they created mannequins about the third the size of a normal mannequin. And down to the fur and the leather and the stitching, painstakingly created these very realistic mannequins of entire lines of products. They put it together, and because they couldn't bring people to the fashion show, they brought the fashion show to the people. And this theater of fashion toured not only all of Europe, but America as well, bringing in orders and bringing in money so that materials could be purchased, clothing could be made, and the orders were filled. And this actually is what put Paris, at least started to put Paris, back at the center of fashion after World War II. So they found a very innovative solution to a very big problem. And how do I know about this, by the way? Well, the theater of fashion actually lives now in my home state of Washington at a local museum. So odd quirk of history that it should come all the way to the west coast of the United States and just stay there, but it did. So that's how I know about it. But drawing on that inspiration of finding innovative solutions, as we'll talk with Mo, your showrooms can now be completely digital, and you can even move past the showroom altogether and straight to your buyer's laptop or tablet. There are tools now existing right now that can seamlessly help you move from the design phase to marketing and sales with the same digital assets. And then digital selling can help you open your products to new buyers never before accessible. And the main reason is we'll talk with Mo. If the buyer can't come to you, but you can come to the buyer, that's a good thing. And that opens more doors. So that said, I think everyone is now here. So let me stop doing most of the talking and let's start talking to Mo. So again, Mo, thanks so much for being on. Yeah.
My pleasure.
Yeah. Okay. So really quick, just kind of want to set the scene. You're in the Netherlands, correct?
Yes, in Amsterdam, exactly.
Okay. So how have the last 6 months been for you as far as the pandemic, just, you know, being there in Amsterdam?
Where to start? Actually, like everybody, it has been quite challenging. I mean, there has been some ups and downs. Let's say until summer, it was mostly downs. And then from summer upward, onward, it started. Basically, the trend has been more on the upside. So we had to go through. I mean, the situation has been pretty much more or less under control until now in the Netherlands. We did have a lockdown. We did have all to work from home, at least for our company. We all the non-essential critical people have to work from home. Only if you have to be in the office, then you are allowed to go there. So yeah, but other than that, it has been okay.
Okay, good. And I was going to say, it sounds like a very similar experience, you know, around the world, where, you know, you're going about your day as normal, and then the next day, yeah, you're working from home. you know, like you said, there are some essential workers getting out there, grocery workers and delivery people and whatnot. But other than that,
it has been very challenging. I mean, especially for me as well. Coincidentally, I had to manage another team on top of my team right when we got into the lockdown. People that I didn't know. So how do you connect with a team that you have never worked with? And the first time it's virtually. So I had to try to find some innovative ways of connecting. So to thank them for the effort, I went to buy chocolate and postcard and then send it individually to all the home addresses, you know, to thank them for the effort that they had to put. So trying to think a little bit out of the box.
I like that. I might actually have to steal that. That's actually pretty good. Because you know what? If I get chocolate in the mail, that's made my day. Right. So, okay. Before we jump into your thoughts on digital selling, can you tell the audience a little bit about your journey to 3D product design? Because you actually came from a career in sales, right? How did those two worlds merge for you? I hear. Yeah. That's a 2-hour story. Sorry.
Exactly. Okay. So yeah, as you say very accurately, I started my career. I started mostly in sales, but in a matter of fact, I started first in project management. Actually, my very first entrance in the career world was in project management. But then at the very early stage, I realized that I really wanted to have a grasp on what the business was. And for me, the way to go there was to go into sales. So to really have an understanding on what the market is, what are the competitors, and what are the business needs. So that's where basically I deviated to sales, and I was, as you say, first account manager and then after that I slowly transitioned to a more strategic role when I worked for Tommy Hilfiger in our, and then Calvin Klein as well during the brief period of time in our headquarters in Europe. I was the link between the markets and the headquarters for our footwear and accessories businesses. So that's basically how I moved to sales, and how I built many years of experience in sales. And about 3 years ago, our company, I moved back to project management to support a huge business transformation program that our company was going through in Europe. And that's why I moved back to project management. And since then, that's what I've been doing. So I'm leading the team, which objective is very much the purpose of our team is to create an enabling environment to improve the way teams work in the purpose of a common in the pursuit of a common goal. So this implies project management. This is what change management is very important. And it goes from organizing workshop, helping team finding the purposes and clarifying the priorities, and 3D design, supporting 3D design has been a part of that, especially for our footwear business.
Nice. Okay. So tell us a little bit about PVH Europe's journey to digital selling. How did you start digitally selling as a company, and what has it led you to accomplish?
Yeah, so I would say it has been a red thread in the company ever since I joined about like a little bit less than 10 years ago.
Oh, okay.
And when I joined, I remember the first seasons, or the first two seasons, we would be printing line books. So it's basically the whole line in some encyclopedia size book, and we would send like with hundreds of pages, tens of them, dozens of them, and then we would send them to all our location and agent across the world. So that would take a lot of time for production. That would take a lot of time as well to ship all of it. And about like two seasons into PVH, we switched to a line book in the iPad, in an iPad. So we send iPads to all our associates across Europe and then the world. And basically all this information that we had in these physical books was in the iPad. And we had directly some big return on investment and immediate benefits of that. The first one is that we didn't have to print and ship them anymore, so we gained time. The second is that we were able to put more information on the product on this iPad line book. So that was great. The third, you could zoom into the product, look, see all the details of the product. And finally, our salespeople didn't have to carry literally suitcases full of books to go to each customer appointment to show them the collection. So that was definitely a big step forward. And I think we were one of the first one in the industry to do that. And about 5 years ago, we started our journey into the digital showroom. So it all started with an idea of, okay, what if we show as many pictures as possible of our product into a digital environment, and therefore reducing the amount of samples that we show in our showrooms? So imagine, we started first with a theater where you have a room where you have a massive giant screen where you display the collection, the key looks, the marketing content. And since the very beginning, it was not only to use it as a tool to show product, but as well the whole thought behind that was that how do we show the power of the brand that generally would go through a room full of samples? How do we show it digitally? How do we recreate this experience, this immersion in the brand universe digitally? So that's what we have been working on a lot with across the whole company. So all the teams were put into that. And incrementally as we were rolling out the concept to all our showrooms across the world, we started decreasing as well the samples that we're producing. So now we are really producing only a fraction of what we used to produce in terms of sample 5 years ago. And so that makes it more sustainable. We have definitely saving money, a lot of money as well. And it's a complete different way of working. And it's not only about the technology, it's a lot, and I think probably 60% of the effort wasn't changing the mindset, training our salespeople, educating our customers as well for them to accept it and creating, taking the feedback and creating enough value for them to accept it and look into our process as well and data management infrastructure to see how we could put all of that together. And actually, in a nutshell, that's 5 years of our digital showroom journey that I tried to condense.
That's great.
Nice. Well, so I mean that means that, you know, with the onset of the pandemic and they're not being able to travel or anything like that, that wasn't something that obviously was the impetus for you for getting this started, because you've been doing it long before. But given everything that's happened this year and people not being able to travel and things like that, what would you say the biggest advantage of that kind of preparatory work that you had done be? What would that biggest advantage be during times like right now? And I asked just as you needed water, of course.
So the biggest advantage was really that, you know, moving from selling digitally face to face to selling remotely, the gap to bridge was not as huge, because we had already a mindset of selling digitally. We had already salespeople who are trained to sell to the customer without showing physical sample. We had already customers who were basically over the past years, they grew really completely used to buying from us digitally. You know, being for the digital showroom. And so we have created as well what is important, trying to create this brand power and experience. We had that as one place. So very much we just had to do a couple of adjustments, so to say, on how we were going to sell to the customers. And it has been basically, for example, to train our salespeople to sell via VC rather than to sell face to face. And as well thinking, okay, if we have these, when you walk into our showrooms, you have only the samples and key looks, and then you have this massive screen, you have these digital tables where you can see all the collection and marketing content, etc. But how do we do it remotely? So how do we make sure that a customer behind his or her laptop is able to have this full experience? And that's basically what we have been putting our efforts in over the past few months, and that's still something that we are working in. And Hatch is actually supporting us in that transition.
Oh,
but we have already done quite some few progress. But of course, there is still some work to do.
So it sounds like the fact that you had already started to acclimate your customers, your buyers to that form of selling has kind of helped you transition, but it's also allowed you to continue to innovate in the space as we've had this interesting year. So you mentioned Hatch, right? And you guys have had a lot of experience here with obviously digital selling coming into right now. So can you tell us a little bit more about Hatch and what you've used to kind of help other brands, you know, learn to do the kind of things that you're doing?
Yeah, sure. So what PDH Europe did is that we took the experience that we had working with the two brands, both Calvin Klein and Tommy Hilfiger, and we put it within a company that is separate from both brands, which is an independent company that is called Hatch Studio. And what they have been doing is really like taking all the know-how. And when I'm talking about know-how, as I said, it's not only about technology is just a part of it, but process, transformation, change management, mindset are equally as important. So how do we taking this experience and then basically being able to apply it and to sell it to other brands? Because we think that we really believe in selling digitally as a company, and our current CEO as well as our former CEO in many instances have made public declaration about that. Our commitment to 3D, our commitment to digital selling, and we, because we believe that it's the way going forward for the fashion industry, and we really think that there is a need over there for that. And if we are able to put this expertise out there, hopefully we can as well bring more fashion company or even tech company to jump into the race and make it go even faster. And because everybody ultimately will benefit from that. So that's the reason why we have this company that is called Hatch, and it's actually, they are actually currently working on really cool projects. Like I just spoke with them this week, and they were telling me how they are focusing now on integrating 3D design, for example. I think that's something that could be interesting for you guys and your customers, how to integrate 3D design in the whole selling, digital selling, and really taking all the advantages of a 3D asset, and not only several angles, pictures of a product, but really like the whole the whole 3D creating a virtual sample room, for example, involving VR, etc., really to enhance the experience of the customers, especially when they are connecting remotely.
Interesting. Just a note here for people in case they missed. Ken did put the link for Hatch up in the chat. So if anybody wants to check it out, the link's right there. So you don't even have to resort to a Google search.
That's right.
But just to kind of follow and continue on that. So you know, I work in 3D and I work in design. So you've got me kind of interested here. What do you see in the future? Do you see as digital selling continues, obviously you're not going to stop doing this anytime soon, at least. Do you see there being any kind of erosion in between things like design and marketing and sales? Do you see those kind of being able to kind of cross boundaries a little bit? Or do you see these still as staying kind of siloed things, but continuing to also digitally transform? What do you see in the future for that?
Yeah, that's a good question. I've been asking myself the same. what I think, and what I have seen over the past 6 months, where we really accelerated our both 3D and digital selling journeys, is that actually that brought the teams together even more so than it was in the past. Because we are all of a sudden we have this jump that we need to do, and not a single team can single-handedly handle that, drive this change. Everybody needs to do that. Everybody needs to contribute. So we really saw a product development, design, tech, merchandising come together and worked to make sure that things happen. And so if anything, I see digitization basically bringing the teams closer together.
Yeah, cool.
That's good to hear. That is good to hear, because you're right. I feel like, you know, the work that people do in the design side should be able to just carry right through to marketing and sales. You know, I mean, literally all that effort and all that knowledge is being poured into that product, and then just to have that design just carried straight through, you know, really essentially straight to the buyer, you know, and marketing just doing a good job of, you know, making some beautiful hero shots and, you know, doing everything the marketing does, you know, but I mean, really from the designer's pen straight to the buyer. Oh, that's a perfect world for me. Perfect. We'll have a chance to talk a little bit with Mo here at the Q&A side, but I want to turn now to Ellery. Ellery, you have some, I know, right? Surprise. Ellery would like to show us what that design process looks like in 2.5D and 3D. With Moto and Colorway. So Ellery, I'll turn it over to you.
Alrighty, sounds good. Let's see. I'm gonna stop sharing my face so that I have more bandwidth to start sharing my screen. So let's do screen. And why does every video conferencing application have to do this differently? and every time I come back to one, it's like I always have to re-educate myself. Share that screen. Yes. Okay, cool. All right, so hopefully if I did this right, everybody sees a shoe up there and not, you know, my email or some random thing like that. But I think we're in good shape. Yes. Cool. So I want to be conscious of time here because I don't want us to run over, and I want to make sure that we have time for questions. But I'll just give kind of a brief overview here for anybody on the call who has not seen or is not familiar with, let me make sure we got everything active. Yep, not familiar with our tools. Foundry creates a couple of tools for kind of enhancing and increasing the speed of visual communication for design. One of those is Colorway and the other one is Moto. And just to kind of give the brief nutshell description before we dive in, Moto is a full-featured 3D application where you can basically do anything from creating shoes, like the stuff that you see on screen, to creating high-quality game assets, to creating models for visual effects for film and television. Pretty much anything that you would want to do in 3D, you can do inside of Moto. Modo also has tools then for putting on materials and lighting and rendering and a lot of things like that. The other half of that is Colorway, which is a 2.5D application that allows you to have a lot of the benefits of 3D visualization without the steep learning curve that comes with learning a full 3D application. Now, Modo has a lot of things that kind of will ease you into the learning process as you're learning 3D. But we know that a lot of designers who are coming in who would like to be able to access this kind of visualization are not familiar with that kind of tool complexity yet. And so Colorway is going to allow them to have that in something that seems very familiar. So I've got the interface for Colorway up right now. And really anybody who's familiar with something like an Adobe suite of applications, Photoshop, Illustrator, InDesign, anything like that, is going to find this fairly familiar. You're dealing with a canvas that has all of your stuff on it. And you've got lists of the things that are in your scene on the left and a bunch of tools on the right. Very, very familiar kind of setup that if you're going to dive in, it doesn't take a lot of training time, doesn't take a lot of, up and running time to be able to sit down and say, okay, I've got this design and I want to create new color and material, new looks and things on it. Now, one thing that we realize is really important is that there are a lot of carryover items that exist in footwear and apparel and in pretty much anything that you're working with in design, where the model, the form, it is going to stay constant, over multiple design cycles. So, something like a simple sneaker, this sneaker is done as kind of a generic foundry branded sneaker, but I think a lot of brands are going to look at a sneaker like this and say, yeah, we've got something like that in our lineup, because it's something that's simple and classic and you're not going to want to completely redesign every year, but you are going to want to come up with, new color work, new materials, new patterns, and things like that. And in order to visualize those things well, kind of the traditional way of doing it is going to be to use something like Adobe Illustrator, where you have line art of the shoe. So, maybe you have line art of a profile of the shoe. And then you would take your patterns, images of swatches or things like that, and they would just kind of go into a clipping mask and fill out the space, and then you get an idea as to what that's going to look like. Now, the downside of that, and there are a couple of downsides that I'd like to focus on are that, you have to set up all of those things manually, right? And if you have, if I wanted to put, say, a pattern or a color or something on, the toe of this shoe, and then I have, let's zoom out here a little bit, and I have, all of these different views of the shoe that I need to consider for my tech pack, then I have to do all of that manually. So I'm going to kind of hop over to a white version of the shoe here, just kind of mostly blanked out, so I can kind of like talk and show at the same time. So for things like colors, that becomes becomes really simple inside of Colorway, because really it's just a matter of either selecting the part that you want to colorize and then picking the colors. So you can see as I go around here, sometimes there'll be a little bit of screen lag between the parts, but you can see as I go around, I can choose a different color, and that's populating across the toe and the tongue in real time for all of these different views. And that's great, because that means then I can see this at a glance and I can really fine tune and say, okay, what exact color, or Colorway has Pantone libraries. So if I want to, let's kind of go down here into the greens and say, okay, I want to see what some of these specific Pantones are going to look like in here. And I've done something to overload my viewport. I scrolled too fast. Or I could have preset palettes. So a lot of times we know that that brands will have seasonal or regional or brand-based palettes. So you can bring in Adobe Swatch Exchange palettes. You can create and save, palette libraries and things in here as well. So it means that you can really quickly kind of flip through and try different things. Now that can be as simple as, hey, I want to color up one part, or maybe you want to go through and you want to be able to do that across multiple parts. So, if, for example, I want to grab, right now I've got to get the yellow off the toe first, because that's just going to drive me crazy here. Let's do a blacked out edition, because I always like the blacked out editions of shoes, right? So let's say I want to take the blue here and I'm just going to obviously black out the blue. And then let's say I want to get everything that's white, and we want it. No, actually, no, let's not go all the way to black here. Let's give ourselves a mild two-toning and put that with a little bit of gray. And then just to make things pop here, let's grab this and let's put something super, super vibrant on that stripe. Let's go for maybe in the kind of limey green color. So, you know, I've taken and created this colorway in really just a few seconds. Now, if I like this and it's something that I want to save, I want to kind of keep in my line here, all I have to do is add that into my collection. And now I've got, you know, multiple different versions. I've got that new version in here for me to explore. And then if I want to take and continue to iterate on that, it's also very simple. So, you know, if I want to take this this kind of black color that I've got here and also apply that back to the heel, I can take and, oops, there we go. I can take and put that on the heel and say, well, let's see, do I like that with it on the heel? Maybe let's also put it on, you know, the interior of the shoe. Yeah, I think I like that. So I'm going to go ahead and add another one there. Now I can see these two, you know, right next to each other. And Colorway is just going to keep track of this all for me as I go along. So, you know, the nice thing about this is visually, as a designer, it allows you to really flesh out your ideas very, very quickly. It allows you to not only say, okay, I've got ideas or I've got palettes or things in mind, but it allows me to cycle through those and see those with a lot more visual fidelity than I otherwise could. You know, coming from a 3D background, you know, having done that for a lot of time myself, you know, changing colors on an object is nothing new, but changing on colors and seeing it instantly in multiple different views is. So even from a 3D perspective, this is great because I'm not waiting for this to re-render. One of the things that my family always says that, you know, if you don't know where Ellery is, he's waiting for something to render. And that's been the comment for the last 25 years because, you know, I've spent a fair portion of my adult life waiting for things to render. You know, this takes that even out of the equation, which is super nice. So then beyond that, then on, you know, kind of continuing on the visual side here, Colorway is also going to allow you to not only place patterns in something that would be, you know, akin to like a clipping mask in Illustrator, but since this is derived from a Modo model that was actually created in 3D space, that's what all these different views were created in, it still understands the three-dimensionality of what's going on there. So that means if I go in here and let's put on a fabric pattern here. So if I go ahead and I put this pattern on here, we'll be able to see that not only is it existing in all of the different locations at once, but it's also going to wrap properly around the 3D model such that if I take and I move it, you can see that it's actually moving in all the different views at once because these different parts are all tied together. So it would be like having a virtual flat pattern that's sitting there. And as I place my fabrics, they're also placing across 3D space the way that they really would. So for doing things like, you know, placing patterns, that's great. You know, going another step forward, if you want to do things like placing graphics, this also becomes really powerful because it means that you can place, and I'm going to go ahead and put on a Modo logo here. It means that I can also place logos and things like that. And this one's going to be really big. So let me scale it down. And right now I've got a tiling Modo pattern, which I don't want. I just want a single Modo logo here. And let's center it up just right. Let's zoom in so I can actually get to this. So let me center that right here. There we go. And so now I've got my Modo logo on here. And the cool thing is I can take this and place this, and maybe I want it just kind of like peeking out from behind the stripes here. And so the placement's going to be pretty specific on where I want to have that. So as I place that, now I can look and see that here on the other views where this is visible, like right here, it's placing in the exact same spot. And that's probably the only other view where I can see it in this case. But any other view where that's visible, I can get that placement and I can lock that down without having to worry about, you know, do I properly represent that? And so as I pass this on to something like a manufacturer, you know, they're going to know, they can see from multiple angles how I want this Modo logo tucked down behind this striping. And that also helps as I connect to, you know, even from that design phase, you know, we're talking about the potential of breaking down those silo walls between design and sales and marketing. You know, this allows me to be able to connect that through. And, you know, we could do things like run marketing, you know, tests and see, you know, do people like the Moto logo there, or do they like it peeking out a little bit more from the stripes? Sorry, I'm stuck on the Moto logo. I'm kind of a Moto fan. But, you know, we can see those kind of things, and we can get that kind of visual feedback early, because we're not just working on, you know, an Illustrator line art. We're working on something that can feel as real as shoe as we would like it to. So inside of Colorway, right now I just have these different views of the shoe, but I could also take this even a step farther, and I could include more photorealistic renderings. I could include contextual renderings where I could see what this would look like, you know, sitting on a display case with other shoes of our own line, or with competitors' shoes next to it, and I could see what that's going to look like live in real time as I'm the designer designing this. And then as I take that and refine that design vision myself, it allows me to better communicate it outwards. So, you know, and then you can kind of continue on, and really the rabbit hole just increases here, because, you know, perhaps now I want to take and we want to try colors on there. You know, we've got the kind of traditional Moto color, but hey, maybe we want to do a throwback to a few years ago when Moto's logo was blue for a while. So we can take and put a blue on there. But you can take and sit and just really iterate extremely quickly on this kind of thing. And as soon as you come across something you like, you can just add a variation. You know, maybe I want to try one with kind of the more traditional Moto logo color, and let's add another variation. And maybe I want to try one with, let's find something that kind of pops off of that fabric just a little bit more here. Maybe we'll go pink. I've got three daughters, so there's a lot of pink in my house. So there we go. Let's add pink on there. So now as I've done that and I've gone along and I've created those iterations, you can see that those have just populated into my contact sheet. And right now I'm sitting in a view where you can't see the placement of the Moto logo. So that's not as helpful as if I do that view. So I'm going to change my whole contact sheet to where it's now looking at the side of the shoe. So now I can go in and I can really just at a glance kind of take in and go across these and go, okay, which one do I really like? Okay, yeah, let's go with the pink one. But this means that as a designer, you can arrive at your own vision faster. And then as you want to communicate your design intent, that becomes significantly easier, because you're allowing yourself to have more robust visualizations. You know, I've known so many great designers that the design in their head is amazing, but they can't always get everybody else to see inside their head. You know, that's what makes them a great designer and me not a great designer, is because I can't see inside their head. So if they want to share that with me, the more tools and the better visual fidelity that they have to be able to communicate that design intent, the more powerful that vision becomes. And it means that more of their good ideas end up, you know, communicated all the way through the pipeline and actually finally being sold. And less of their really good ideas, just because they couldn't communicate them, end up in the garbage can. And that's kind of the end goal that I think that we've had as we've produced these tools, is how do we get those good designs onto the shelves, digital or physical, and how do we get less of those good designs, you know, going out to trash? So let's, I'm going to hop over to another example here. So, you know, this is a good look at something where we see, you know, lots of rubber and fabric and that kind of thing. So I'm going to show something that's a bit different here. So looking at leathers. So really, I just kind of want to show a little bit of the versatility here. And so same kind of things going on here, but I'm dealing now just with a few different parts of this shoe. It's a much simpler shoe, but it is now working in a leather. And we understand that in this case, we're looking at leather with kind of like the worn patina look. And, you know, that's something that can be very specific. And, you know, depending on the company, there's a lot of process into how that's created and you know, to give the look that is, you know, iconic for whatever brand you may be looking at. Well, I've taken this one so that inside of Colorway, I can take and even recolor and adjust that patina. Now, if I wanted to, I could go nuts and take this a step farther, where I could even go in and adjust the actual polishing of where that falls and how the darker edges fall along there. I didn't do that for this one, but it's something that you do have the ability to do. You can take and kind of layer on different levels of design, just as you would with a pattern or a texture or something like that. But in this case, if we look with here, let me go to a little bit more of a neutral one. This one you can see has a swatch of leather in here, so you can see the grain of the leather on the shoe, and then it also has the, you know, the darkened edges here. But I can go in, and it's probably going to be easier if I go in and just grab this right here. There we go. I can go in and I can adjust the coloration of that. You know, maybe I want that to be a little bit lighter. I don't want it to be quite as dark, so I can pull that up. You know, maybe I want it to be a little bit more honey colored, or maybe I want that to be a little bit more ruddy. Maybe I even want to go something kind of nuts and make it a little bit cooler. No, I can't do that. It's butchering it too much. So you can go in and you can really fine tune and tweak and design this. And, you know, just as you can see me fumfering through and making that bad decision here and going, hey, I've got an idea. What if we made it look like this? You know, I can immediately see that that's a bad idea. But sometimes there are bad ideas that are not well communicated verbally, just like there are good ideas that are not well communicated verbally. But if I was telling you about this great idea I had for a shoe with the blue patina, you know, maybe you'd buy into that if I sold that really well. But as soon as I show you this image, you're going to say, yeah, no, let's not do that. And then we'll just take that and dump it in the trash and go with something more traditional. So really that's what we're looking at here with colorways, allowing to empower visualization and just get you closer to your finished designs faster. So I won't go into the rest of it here too much because I want to be sensitive that we're getting close on time. But just one other note here inside of colorway is that it really falls into two big categories. And we've focused, and you know, most of today we've focused on, you know, the visual aspect, because that's what we use for design. That's what we use for, you know, if you're selling something online or if you're buying something online, you might not really care about the nitty gritty of how it's constructed, but that is something that also can be helpful here inside of colorway, in that we have every designer's favorite part, which is the spreadsheet. And the spreadsheet here is actually super cool, though, because as I switch through different design iterations, I got to zoom in here where you can actually see it happening. You can see that it's easy to tell with just the colors. The colors are changing, and my computer's freezing on me. There we go. The colors are changing here through there. Now, in this case, it's just colors, but the more I have this interconnected, if I have this hooked up to a PLM or something like that, which I don't have at the moment, any information that's on my PLM can also flow into here. So if I'm using swatches from real patterns or things like that, any information that's on that pattern comes into here. So you can see that across the top here, I have a bunch of different categories. Some of them are cut off because I made this pretty small, so it was out of the way. But I have information like the currency, the cost, the manufacturer, the location of each individual material. So just puts more information into the designer's hand, and also means that they don't have to do that manually. Because if that data is important, and it is something that you need with every design iteration that you make. As a designer, if I go through here and I make, you know, 7, 8 variations of this, but I forgot to update my spreadsheet on number 4, then that data is something that we got to go back and find and look for. This just allows you to have that there without ever having to worry about it. And then when it's needed, it's there. When it's not needed, it just is out of the way and you don't have to worry about it. So between allowing you to more quickly and fluidly visualize your designs, and then allowing to more easily connect those designs to a broader ecosystem, we think that colorway is a really, really powerful tool that can help you get from your design to your design idea to your finished design, and ultimately what you're selling faster. I'll cut there. You know, we didn't want to dive into Modo too much today because we wanted to make sure that we had plenty of time for conversation and for any questions to follow up. That's colorway in a nutshell. And I'm going to stop sharing then, and I'll hop back on video and we'll go back in and check questions.
Love it. Okay, thank you so much, Ellery. And you know, we wanted to showcase this because obviously, you know, in our conversation with Mo, we're talking about digitally selling. Well, this really is, you know, colorway and Modo can be the headwater of where a lot of that eventually flows down to then talking digitally and selling digitally with your wholesale buyers and, you know, so on and so forth. And even on into e-commerce, right? It's something we didn't touch on, you know, because, you know, we wanted to focus specifically on talking to the wholesaler, but really it can flow both directions. So that said, I did want to quickly, Mo, it looks like we've got a question or two for you, but before we go there, Ellery, I just kind of wanted to, we had a question come in actually before the webinar, and just wanted to start off with that. Okay, so we looked a lot at ColorWave, but how long does it take to become, say I'm a 2D designer, okay? Sure. How long does it take me to become proficient in something like ColorWave?
Oh, and something like ColorWave is pretty quick. If you have, if you have proficiency, as you said, in other 2D design applications, really it's the kind of thing where, a day of training gets you pretty much up to speed and you know where everything is. And then after that, it's always going to be a matter of practice, putting it into practice. If you learn about it for a day and then don't use it for 6 months, obviously it's not going to sink in. But it's the kind of thing where in a day you can get a good understanding of how everything works. And then if you are using it even just a bit day to day, it can sink in fairly quickly. We see a lot of designers take to it very quickly, and really after a day of training and a few questions can pretty much be up to speed and ready to go. And it's intuitive enough an interface that you can actually just kind of dive in and start poking around and clicking stuff. Obviously that's not going to be the ultimate learning experience, but you can just start, if you have some assets ready, that you just start kind of clicking and pulling on colors. What happens if I drag this there, you can even start exploring it that way. But, typically I see about a day of training being the best way to get going. And then you just dive in and start designing from there. Okay. It's about the application getting out of your way mostly and allowing designers to design, which is what they do well.
Yeah. Okay. Well, thank you. So Mo, actually, I had a good question come in that I'll do this one first and then go back to some of the others that came in, but it's kind of interesting. I'd love your take. So what do you think would be upcoming trends regarding how we sell, whether it be like augmented reality, new apps with iPhone, making it more of a mobile experience, LiDAR scanner, which I'm not exactly sure what that is, but I'll throw it in there. What do you see as like some of the coming trends that might enhance the digital selling process?
Yeah. So, wow.
I know. Jump you right into the deep end.
I mean, the first thing is that definitely, remote selling is here to stay. This is very clear. And what is going to happen is that we will be selling through different ways. We will be looking into what are the technologies that as brands allow us to, as I was saying again, and I repeat it, to really create that full experience for our customers, for our buyers. So here I'm talking really from a sell-in perspective, so from a B2B perspective. Mm-hmm. And it's very much what is going. So is it going to be a digital showroom, virtual showroom, augmented reality, VR? From our side, for example, we believe that with Hatch, for example, of creating virtual sample rooms, for example, where you can walk in and have meetings in a virtual sample room. Currently, already for this season, we are working for the season that we are going to sell very soon, we have a virtual showroom where our customers are able to interact with the digital showroom directly remotely. So they can change their looks, etc., like have that full experience. So I think a lot of it is coming. So sorry if my answer might be a little bit vague on that sense. No. But I try to give some of the directions that from my understanding I think is definitely happening.
Yeah, no, that's cool. That's cool. I was gonna say, just being able to continue that process of innovation with that digital environment. That's pretty amazing. And yeah, I agree with you. I don't see us ever really going back to the way we did things pre-pandemic. We may take a couple steps back and a couple things, but really I feel like this is a catalyst moment for us. to really push us towards digital. Cool. So actually, Ellery, one came in for Colorway. The question came in, would Colorway work on changing the texture and color of a 3D model and or larger 3D assets?
Oh, sure. Yeah, so pretty much anything anything you can render out of Modo. if you can throw a Modo at it, you can throw it in Colorway. but yeah, basically anything that you could render in Modo can come into Colorway. So you know, for example, that could be anything from CAD models of, you know, really complex machinery that might have, you know, multiple parts that's, you know, all sorts of different things interlocking, and you want to be able to go in and, you know, look at paint finishes and things on, you know, on different parts and things like that. That could go into there. We see it used for consumer packaged goods. We see it used for, you know, a lot in footwear, apparel, fashion, that kind of thing. But beyond just changing up the, you know, the look of the footwear or the shirt or the dress, whatever it may be, you could even color up your mannequins. So if you wanted to do stuff with things like that and have a character that you edit inside of Colorway, that's pretty much all flexible and all there. Anything that you can edit inside of the 3D space can flow into Colorway and be edited there as well.
No, that's cool.
So short answer is yes.
Yeah. Okay. And by the way, I hope Mo and Ellery, hands down, if you haven't looked at the polls yet, what would you guess is the most people, the items that people most spend on when they're just doing their personal online shopping? Choices are clothing / footwear, personal care, groceries, entertainment, whether it be movies, books, gaming, etc., hobby equipment, gifts, or others. What's your guess?
I'm gonna go entertainment.
Okay, I got one for entertainment. Mo, what's your guess?
Oh, I would have said toilet paper.
Yes,
personal care. Okay.
I think hobby could be could be. Yeah.
Mo gets it.
Hmm.
Mo gets it. Yeah. By a somewhat wide margin.
Really?
Yeah. Huh. Hobby equipment of assorted types wins the day. Oh, good job. All right. Okay. Cool. Well, that means, Mo, you get the next question. that's what you win. So, and by the way, I realize that we're coming up against the top of the hour. We will stay on just a couple extra minutes to make sure all the questions are answered. You know, please feel free to peel off as you need to if you have other meetings, but we'll stay on just a couple extra minutes to finish these questions. Mo, a question came in. What would be like the ideal approach to forming a distribution, you know, network for digitally selling? I get the sense that, I mean, obviously you already have an existing sales force that's out there. PVH Europe already has that, specifically Tommy Hilfiger has that. But maybe just describe a little bit, like, what was the transition of working from the salespeople flying out to their buyers to then just turning the tables and getting the digital catalogs out to their buyers? What was that process like? How did they have to reconfigure to think more virtually?
Yeah, So basically the customers always flew to our showroom in most cases.
There we go. Okay.
So they were coming to our showrooms and they would basically see the collection. So they would enter a room full of samples. Now when they go into our showroom, now they don't go so much into our showrooms. Yeah. I mean, a couple of them still in some of the countries where they are allowed to, and some very handpicked customers still going to the showroom. But even those customers going into the showroom would have been a year or two ago. They would enter in a room where basically we'd show only our, showcase only our key looks. And the room will basically not have sample. So which makes that we have a very clear message as well on what we want to be out there as a brand, and the rest of the information is shared digitally. So that's one point. So when it comes to, and again, this works very well in a wholesale environment, because that's where there is really a very strong added value to that. If we were a vertical, maybe we wouldn't have need to get this digital showroom and whole brand experience for our customers, etc. But as we are a company that has a very big wholesale business, then that was important for us to bring these customers in and really to have this full experience. So when it comes to, if I understand well your question, it all starts with having the salespeople on board. So it does not mean that we had all in a sudden to fire all our existing sales force and replace them. No, we didn't do that. We trained our sales force, and some of them had been in the business for 20, 30 years, and we trained them to be able to sell virtually, and now they are the first advocate of selling virtually. We had some customers when I come in who are sending us orders via fax, and now they are placing the orders, you know, remotely, directly through the virtual showroom. So yeah, it's a lot, as I said, about changing the mentality, training your sales team, who then will be your ambassadors to then train your customers.
Yeah, that's, as I said, that's really cool to hear, Mo, that you have some very seasoned salespeople that, you know, probably, you know, when they started their career, were lugging around the encyclopedias, you know, and to all of a sudden now, you know, they're just loving it, you know, selling it virtually. That's cool stuff. Okay. Well, it looks like the last question then is to you, Ellery. I'll say, I feel like I could answer this one, but I'll let you answer. They write in, Miriam, it looks like, writes in, would you say these applications are useful for film and TV as well, or mainly just business?
That's a good question. Modo, I would say without hesitation is great for film and TV. It's an excellent 3D modeler. And usually where we do see Modo used in a lot of applications outside of kind of what we've been talking about today, since models can really be created anywhere and Modo is a really good 3D modeler, usually it will fit into a pipeline and come in using its modeling and its UV layout skills or tools are very good. Now Colorway, as far as in a film and TV aspect, I would say it would be probably less useful, mainly because typically the end use case where we see is where Colorway becomes really powerful is that it allows designers who are less technically savvy, who are, you know, using 2D applications and really want to be able to just have a better way to visualize their designs digitally very quickly, getting quality of 3D rendering and all that kind of thing without having to learn everything. That tends to be less the case when you're talking about a similar role in TV and film, where they would probably be using something like Nuke, which is another Foundry product, but actually it is something that is very, very frequently used in TV and film. And in a lot of ways, the concept is very similar. It's taking something that has been rendered or filmed or whatever the case may be, and then it's making adjustments and changes to it after the fact. Really very similar to what you're doing in Colorway, except it's doing it without any of the guides. You know, you can build everything up from scratch, which for something like TV, film, visual effects, that kind of thing is very important, because you get down to, well, that explosion needs to feather out a little bit more in this direction. You know, the kind of controls that you need are a bit different. So I would say that Modo does become really really good for 3D application for TV and film, and for kind of the recoloring and re-editing side, I would say you would kind of go with the bigger brother and Nuke, something like that, that is more geared towards that kind of thing. And also that's going to work on moving picture film, that kind of thing. Colorway is mostly geared, there are some things that you can do, but is mostly geared towards still imagery for design and that kind of thing. Now, that said, for something like look development, I think it actually could be an interesting thing. So if you're doing, you know, look development on something for, you know, I'm a sci-fi nut. So, you know, if you've got your spaceship that you want to look at paint jobs and you want to look at, you know, decals and weathering and things like that, you could want on actually doing it in colorway could be kind of interesting. And now that's got me interested. Now I might build a spaceship to pull into colorway just because why not? Right. But yeah, I think that's where that becomes very quick is when you don't want to wait for re-render is the main thing. But it's for the designer that is less interested in the tool and more interested in how they can visualize their stuff more quickly without having to learn all of the, you know, all of the intricacies of a 3D application or of Nuke or something like that.
Well, thank you. And actually the reason why I wanted to make sure to include that question is because it does kind of segue eventually back to what we're talking about with Mo is that, yes, you know, with Modo and Colorway, that's the headwaters of the design process and actually creating the product. But then eventually it needs to flow down to marketing and by extension sales so that these products can be then shown digitally and whatnot. And, you know, marketing needs to make them look beautiful and, you know, do fun sizzle reels and stuff like that. And then sales needs to be able to take them into a virtual environment and show them off in, you know, stunning photorealistic quality. So they all start to, as Mo, you were talking about, they all start to kind of, I like you see a time in the near future when a lot of these different siloed departments start to blend together more and, you know, digital assets are being handed back and forth. So it's kind of a wrap up because I know we're going very long, but Mo, I just want to give you the final word. I mean, yeah, the pandemic has kind of shaken the industry, but are you excited for the future? Are you excited about the direction that we're going with digital selling?
Oh yeah, definitely, definitely. I mean, as I said, when I started 10 years ago. Almost within the company. I've seen all the progress that we have done where we went from sending these dictionaries, encyclopedia to our customers across four different continents to our agent and showrooms across four continents. And now we are able to sell digitally and we are looking into virtual showrooms. We are looking into enhancing the virtual experience of our customers, and I think it's great. I mean, it's great for time, and it's great for team collaboration, and most importantly, it's great for the environment. I mean, the less sample we produce as an industry, that the better it's going to be for everybody. We are not shipping samples left and right. We are not producing samples. All of that will definitely have a much greater impact on a positive impact on the environment. And let's face it, I mean, the fashion industry is one of the most polluting industries, and we all need to make our contribution to be more sustainable and start already with digital selling.
Yeah.
So I'm really excited about that, and all the and as I say, I mean, I'm not an expert like the guys from Hatch in terms of, you know, what is the future and envisioning what the future is coming. But from the information I have, it's very exciting. It's great.
Awesome. Well, Mo, Ellery, it's been a pleasure speaking to you both. And I was going to say, hopefully we can do this again sometimes. Mo, it's great hearing from you. Much appreciated.
Very much.
Yeah, thank you guys.
All right. Thanks everyone for joining. Take care.
See you guys.